Honda, who used to be the Sanskrit professor in Utrecht for many years. And I think he died some 20 years ago. And with the endowments, we can accommodate, we can house some 3 to 4 fellows at IIS, fellows who are specializing in what we generally call Indology, so the study of Indian culture from India and beyond. There's a lot of Sanskrit involved. And that leads me directly to the speaker of today, Rocco Cestola, who is going to talk about an aspect of death and yoga. You've seen the title, Fading into Death through Patanjali Yoga. And Rocco is going to talk for about half an hour, after which you can ask questions, but you can ask the questions also during the lecture by just using the chat modem. And I will have a look at your questions and pass them on to the speaker. So we think Rocco will talk till about, Dutch time, 11:30, so about half an hour. And then we have another half hour for questions and answers, after which I want to close the meeting. But for about half an hour, Rocco will remain online so you can continue your discussion. So Rocco, I would like to not pass the floor, but pass the screen to you.
So I will start again, expressing my thankfulness to Willem, to who has introduced me, and to the IIS Institute, as well as to the Royal Dutch Academy of Arts and Sciences, who have granted me this opportunity to introduce my topic. This topic, this lecture is entitled Fading into Death through Patanjali Yoga. And it deals with the advanced phase of absorption of meditation. And during this phase, the practitioner of yoga finds herself or himself in a sort of dead-like state. Before proceed any further, I would like to apologize myself if my English is not proper English, and so I can continue to how to change the slide here. Okay. So this topic will concern mainly the yoga darshana of Patanjali here, which is a system of philosophy, as you can see here from this slide. I will refer to this system of philosophy, to the Patanjali system of philosophy, through those terms: Patanjali Yoga Darshana, Yoga Shastra of Patanjali, Yoga Darshana, Patanjali Yoga. This system of philosophy is grounded on this root text that, of which you can see the title here, which is Patanjali Yoga Shastra, which means the systematic teaching of the yoga of Patanjali, which is a text having two layers. The first layer is the root text, I would say, which is composed by the aphorism, which in Sanskrit are named sutra. And those aphorisms have a bhashya, namely a commentary, explaining them. So the both sutra and bhashya are, though can be detached, are entitled as a whole text, Patanjali Yoga Shastra. Why we refer to this system of philosophy as Patanjali? Because we presume that the author of this text or the editor of this text is Patanjali. If he was the author or not, it's still debated, but I myself assume that he was the author or the editor of the aphorism, as well as the comment on them. So, since we are dealing mainly with a literary topic, I would like to introduce all the texts dealing with Patanjala Yoga Darshan, and which, and as you can see from this slide, are quite many and ranges from the 4th century current era up to the last century. So the root text, the Patanjala Yoga Shastra, is the main text upon which all those other texts that you can see here represent comments on this text. And how did I came across this topic of death-like states? Because during my PhD, I was editing this text, the Brihati Vritti of Nagesha Bhatta, which is a late author and commentator on yoga. While editing this text, I came across a very interesting and peculiar expression referring to the advanced phase of yoga practice, and this expression is meritavat. It's meritavat, and it's found, as I said, in the Brihati Vritti of Nagesha Bhatta. While studying this text, I also found that the same expression occurs also in another commentary, which is the Yoga Vartika of Vijnana Bhikshu, which is the text upon which Nagesha Bhatta has written his own commentary, and the text that was mainly used by Nagesha Bhatta to write his own text. What expression, what parts of the Yoga Sutra we are mainly dealing with, which is commented by Nagesha Bhatta and Vijnana Bhikshu, is this sutra, which is found in the first chapter of Yoga, of Patanjala Yoga Shastra, and it's the aphorism 18. And this is the text, Virama Pratyaya Vyasa Purvaha Samskara Shesho Anyaha. And I translated the other form of samadhi, namely Asamprajnata Samadhi, is a residue of latent impressions, and it takes place when the inhibitory drive is firmly applied. So here, Anya, which is translated as the other, is referring to Asamprajnata Samadhi, which is the more advanced phase of absorption, which is reached once the previous phase of absorption is completed. And the other phase is simply called Samprajnata Samadhi, which is the difference between them is the presence of the support or object of meditation, which vanishes as soon as the practitioner reaches the Asamprajnata Samadhi. This state, it consists mainly of those samskaras, which are latent impressions, and those samskaras are which now remains, are those only related to this very life of the practitioner, and not to the past lives. How this advanced state is reached through this inhibitory drive. And this inhibitory drive permits and enables the practitioner to void his or her mind of any possible psycho or physical stimulus. And it's the only way to achieve through the different stages of meditation. As we can see from this slide, I try to collect some terms occurring in the Yoga Bhashya cast upon the Yoga Sutra 118. And as perhaps you might see, those terms are mainly show mainly negative bias. Why? Because they refer to a state of mind which is basically void of any content. So I try to analyze and to distinguish three aspects of this state of Asamprajñāta Samādhi. So, and from the practical standpoint, the yogin has to apply this Param Vairagyam, which is the higher form of detachment. Detachment from what? From all the possible thoughts or physical stimuli. And how it's applied, this Param Vairagyam, through Virama Pratyaya, which is actually a kind of inhibitory drive preventing the rising up of any mental or physical content. So, and from the object standpoint, we can say that during Asamprajñāta Samādhi, there is no object, as it we can see from those three terms, 1, 2, and 3. And what happens in the practitioner's mind? The mind is shut down, and mind apparently looks as if it were non-existent, and it consists only of latent expression, latent impression, sorry. So finally we can see where the expression dead-like occurs. And so this is the text of Vijñāna Bhikṣu. I will read the translation. The mind, conditioned by a firm attitude of higher detachment, loses its meditative support, content, and appears as if non-existent, just as if cadaverous, because nothing is to be done. In the passage of Yoga Bhashya, beginning with Iti, it is told that this is a peculiar condition. This is called the seedless samadhi, nirbija. That means a condition void of latent drives, due to which there is action and knowledge amounting to the seed of life. Alternatively, it can also mean the uprooting of the seed of samsara, known as subliminal drives. Also, Nagesha Bhatta has something to say about this, and he uses no more no less a similar expression. And so, consequently, the mind which has continuously practiced the higher detachment becomes void of the content. It seems non-existent, as if it was in a dead-like state, because it has no function to absorb. Therefore, it is said to be the contentless samadhi, which is a condition where there is no activity causing birth in the world. I marked in bold type both expression in here, Meritavad as well as Meritakavad, who no more no less has the same meaning, and which are the expression that I would like to make sense of now. In fact, what actually is happening to the yoga practitioner? first of all, to reach this higher state of meditation, the practitioner has to apply Nirodha. As I just said, Nirodha is the full shutting down of any mental state. So, as you can see in this slide, I'm sorry if it's full of details, but I think it can be somehow interesting to see all of them. We have basically three parts here. One is one, and two, and three. And I can say that these parts here, these parts here represent the ontological space of Yoga Shastra, which is that space, that physical space that the yogi tries to absorb into himself or herself while meditating. And as for this part on the left, Parvani is a kind of a grouping of mapping of these ontological elements. Any of those elements form the universe, or as well as the body of any individual subject. The yoga practitioner, when meditates, he or she goes through these four stages: vitarka, vichara, ananda, and asmita. Those four stages represent the samadhi with content, which is called samprajñāta. Within this state, the practitioner shuts down all the mental contents, and he reaches this knowledge, which is called awareness, which is called viveka khyati, which is the knowledge of distinction in between the guna of prakriti, in particular the sattva guna of prakriti, and the purusha. In fact, the aim of the yoga is to let abide the true self, which is this purusha, in its own self. And to do this, the yogi has to absorb, to meditate, and to go all through these stages. So these stages are those four, marking particular phases of meditation. So once the yogin has reached this asmita state, which is the state in which he or she absorbs his own conception of himself or herself. Asmita actually means the high cognition, the high awareness of one's own ego. So once he applying always Nirodha on this stage, the practitioner finds himself or herself into this condition, which is Dharma Mega Samadhi, which marks the threshold of Asamprajñāta Samadhi, that is the highest phase of meditation. Once in this phase, he can reach or she can reach the Kaivalya, which is the condition of Purusha. Kaivalya means contentless of seeing. To reach the Purusha, to let abide the Purusha in itself, as I said, the most important and technical term is Nirodha, that is the shutting down or inhibitory practice, which is very important in yoga. There are quite many varieties of this Nirodha, as we can see here, because at first we have the Nirodha of the Chittavrittis. Chittavritti are the mental and physical contents. And then we have the Pratyaya Nirodha, which is the applying of Virama Pratyaya, as we saw before, the inhibitory drives that let the practitioner progress into his absorption. Then we have the samskara nirodha, which is the shutting down of those samskaras left, as we saw in this that we saw here, the samskara shesha. And once the yogin finds himself or herself consisting only on those samskara left, he or she abides in this state, which is called the Nirodha Samadhi, which is the full shutdown of all mental contents. And it's the state in which it is possible to reach, as we saw before, this Kaivalya, and so the Purusha. And now, what exactly does the practitioner to reach those states? How finds himself or herself? As we say, he or she should apply the Nirodha as well as the detachment to reach those advanced states. But above all, from a physical standpoint, what does he or she does? Basically, he practices or she practices the postures, which enables the practitioner to reach those advanced phases. And how should this posture be practiced? The posture, as we can see here from another aphorism taken from the Yoga Sutra, the posture must be steady and comfortable, and it arises either from the slackening of effort or from merging into meditatively into infinity. Because of that, one is not afflicted by the pairs of unpleasant sensations. So that is to say that the practicing of asanas, it's very important to go through all the stages of meditation, as we saw. Namely, the practicing of asanas enables the yogin to go through all those four stages up to Dharma Megha Samadhi and then to Kaivalya, in order to realize the Purusha. I present this slide to you in order to visually see what can happen during the meditation. Starting from right to left, we have here the practitioner, let's say, while absorbed, but still in the world. In the middle, we can see the practitioner, where the practitioner abiding, let's say, in its own ego, in its own or her own identity. And while applying Nirodha on those two conditions, he or she at the end find himself here, which is, we could interpret this image as the contentless samadhi, so the being void of content of the mind, and so this just bare color, golden color, can be a representation of the absolute, as the title bears. So I really hope you might like this image, because I find it quite telling about the yoga practices, as well as quite nice, especially the color is used. So before to proceed any further, what the practitioner actually does during yoga, and why he or she finds itself dead. Fundamentally, this dead-like state, it's referred to it's used to refer to the mind, which is fully shut down. But once the mind is fully shut down and the yogin let abide his or her own self, it happens that he can somehow come back to life, and he or she is now verging in a kind of jivan mukti state, which means liberation in life. And this state of being liberated while staying alive is perhaps, we could say, the mark of a realized yogin. And that is the fundamentally the reason why the yogin undergoes this very intense practice. But still, there is a way in which we can interpret this practice of yoga, which is not only related to us, to those ascetics practicing yoga, but also for the layman. Why? As we can read from this stanza of Kalidasa, we can see how yoga is also used as a way to prepare the body to prepare one's own body to the time of the departure from the body, so to the time of death. So Kalidasa here says that I will tell you about the dynasty of Raghus, who spent their own adolescence in the study of letters, enjoyed pleasures in their youth, led an anchorite lives in their old age, and who, in the end of their lives, released their bodies by means of yogas. So I use these stanzas from Kalidasa just to show in which sense we can relate the yoga to a death-like state. And in the sense, as I just said before, yoga is it's not only meant for in the imaginary of South Asian culture, is not only meant for ascetics, but also for laymen who can use the yoga to pleasantly, let's say, departure from their own bodies. And still, it is curious to me why those expressions we have seen are used in the text. I find them a little bit ironic as well as austere and severe at the same time. But in a sense, the expression mritavat and mritakavat points and refers to literally to what is going on in the mind of the practitioner while he or she is deeply absorbed in the highest phase of meditation. So, as those two authors we saw, Nagesha Bhatta and Vijnana Bhikshu, say, those practitioners look like dead bodies, look like dead, and look like corpse somehow. But what does it mean? Fundamentally, it means that they are not exactly dead, but they are alive, but in another condition, in a different condition, which is this condition here, which is the condition of the Purusha, as it's technically called in the text, in the Patanjali Yoga Shastra. And the Purusha, as we say, represents the true with a capital T, the true self with a capital S of the yoin, and letting abide the self in its own nature, in its own state, is fundamentally the aim of Patanjala yoga. To reach this condition, once more, we have to void the mind. The practitioner has to void the mind of its content up to its fullest degree. And once he realized this, the yogin, so he abides in himself, and it's fully, and he or she can finally obtain moksha, namely the liberation. So I have concluded my talk, and in particular, I wish to express my gratitude to the KNAW, to the IIES staff, to Jason Birch and Daniela Bevilacqua, to Lisa Caviglia and Peter Pasendak. Probably soon you will like the result of this talk. Probably you will see in the future in a paper that I'm completing with the help of Lisa Caviglia. So I hope you enjoyed so far my talk, my lecture. If you have any question, please, you are free to address me with any sort of curiosity of questions or the like.